السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
الله أكبر والله أكبر. الله أكبر والله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. هيا على الصلاة. هيا على الصلاة. هيا على الفلاح. هيا على الفلاح. الله أكبر والله أكبر. لا إله إلا الله.
الحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله رب السماوات ورب الأرض رب العالمين، وله الكبرياء في السماوات والأرض وهو العزيز الحكيم، رب المشرقين ورب المغربين. يعلم ما يلج في الأرض وما يخرج منها وما ينزل من السماء وما يعرج فيها، وهو معكم أينما كنتم، والله بما تعملون بصير. من كان يريد العزة فلله العزة جميعا، إليه يصعد الكلم الطيب والعمل الصالح يرفعه. من يهدي الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، الملك الحق المبين. وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله وأمين على وحيه. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر نفس ما قدمت لغد، واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, we come on Friday and in every prayer to express our gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to acknowledge our shortcomings and our weakness and our need for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to seek His guidance, His help, His protection, His forgiveness. And we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept the little we do, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from all of us, inshallah, our fasting and our prayers in this blessed month. We also come to remind one another of our duties and to support each other to fulfill those duties, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises the believers who do that. العصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. Allah praises believers who remind each other of what needs to be done, of their duties and the truth, and support each other in fulfilling their duties. My dear respected brother and sister in Islam, every now and then we are reminded that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us so much. And a lot of these gifts, we take them for granted. And we only remember them when we lose them. There are so many things that Allah has given us that unfortunately we may not appreciate them and we take them for granted. Just the fact that you wake up healthy or you are healthy, that's a big favor and gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When do we appreciate this? When we get sick. Then we remember how important it is to be healthy and how much we need to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for those bounties and gifts. The fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made us Muslims, that's a great gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can't imagine what's going to happen if we were not guided to this path of the true path or the straight path. Also, every now and then we are reminded of our weakness, how weak we are and how dependent we are on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to how much we need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Minor pain goes anywhere in your body, makes your life miserable. And remind you how weak you are and how badly we need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ أَنْتُمُ الْفُقَرَاءُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ هُوَ الْغَنِيُّ الْحَمِيدُ. It is us who need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala desperately and badly. And one purpose of the ibadah, one purpose of the ibadah is to express this gratitude. One main purpose of the ibadah is you worship to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you want to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah tells you how to do that. You do it by praying, by fasting, etc. That's the way to express your gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So ibadah is an expression. It is meant to express feelings, to express your love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to express your gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to express your dependence on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what ibadah is about. If those feelings are not there, the ibadah becomes very obsolete, very mechanical. Because as I said, it is meant to be an expression. Ibadah, worship, is meant to be an expression of those feelings. The other purpose of the ibadah is empowerment. You worship to seek help and empowerment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do what? To fulfill the mission that Allah has assigned you. So we worship Allah to seek strength, to seek spiritual energy, so that we can continue to fulfill the mission that Allah has assigned to us. If a Muslim abandons that mission, ibadah also becomes obsolete, loses the other purpose. So there are two purposes of worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One, to express our love, our fear, our gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our reverence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, expression of those feelings. And two, seeking the help from Allah to fulfill the mission that He has assigned us. Unfortunately, in many cases, the feelings are not there, and people have already neglected and abandoned their mission. That's why the ibadah became lost a lot of its meaning and importance and became a routine act that we do that sometimes has no effect on us. Now, my dear respected brother and sister in Islam, today we continue to be in the best month of the year, in the best 10 days of this month. It's Jumu'ah, the best day of the week, and it may be the best day of the year. It might be the night of Qadr, which is the best night of the year. So that's a very special day. This is a very special day. And I'd like to remind all of us that this great month is about to finish. We're talking about 4 or 5 days, and it's over. Many of us are maybe tired by now, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from His blessing, kept most of the opportunities in these days, so that when we are very tired, we get a lot of incentive and motivation to push ourselves more. Why? Because of those opportunities in these last 10 days. Remember that one of the nights might be the night of Qadr, which is better than life. Better than life. Because 1,000 months, that's life. And remember that these are the days of observance from hellfire. People, there are people whom Allah will declare exempt from hellfire. عتق من النار. That's the ultimate goal of believers, to make this list. And of course, as we're heading toward the end of Ramadan, we want to be among those who have fasted and prayed this month, imanan wa ihtisaban, so that we get all our sins forgiven. That's what Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa promises, man sama ramadanan imanan wa ihtisaban, غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه ومن قام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. You fast Ramadan seeking the pleasure of Allah with sincerity, you will get all your sins forgiven. You pray at night in Ramadan seeking the pleasure of Allah and with sincerity, you get all your sins forgiven. We are now very close to the finish line. And as I said, we need to accelerate. We need to come up with energy to dig out. We still have energy, still have potential. And if we push ourselves, you will be surprised with how much more energy you have and potential, even though you think that you are exhausted and you run out of energy. This time, alhamdulillah, in these days, we probably, some of us maybe have experienced the feeling of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions when they were staying up at night even though they are very tired and they want to sleep and they were battling sleep, yet they are staying up at night to read the Quran and to pray. This is it's a very special feeling that, as I said, is we're imitating in a way what Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions have been experiencing, especially in this month. So what's the point here? The point is, like in exercise, where do you get the most benefit in exercising? When you push beyond the limit. When you push yourself beyond your limits. Spirituality, you develop your spirituality more effectively when you push yourself beyond your limit. So in these days, when you are going to be praying and staying up at night, even though you are very tired and exhausted, that's the best spiritual development you can hope for. Why? Because you are pushing your limits. You're going the extra mile. You're challenging yourself. And you're pushing yourself. That's the best spiritual development you can hope for. As long as you're going to do things that are convenient, you're not going to improve. That's maintenance. You will only maybe maintain what you have. You want to go to the next level, you're going to have to challenge yourself and push yourself. And that's the opportunity we have. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as I said, from His mercy, gave us an opportunity that we cannot miss. I mean, you think about going to sleep, and then you remember that this might be the night of Qadr. We can sleep later. I need to take advantage of this time. I cannot miss it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put huge opportunity in these days, so that we can use it to go beyond our fatigue and tiresome and push ourselves, inshallah, to get the best spiritual development and spiritual exercise you can think of. The best way to make sure that you take advantage of this night of Qadr is to work every night, because nobody knows which night it is. I know many people think that it is on night of the 27th. It's not. It can be any night. So the only way to guarantee that you catch it is to work every night. This way, no matter which night it is, then you should have you will be among those who took advantage of it. Yes, there are more chances on the odd nights, and we still have one tonight. That's Friday night, and one Sunday night on the 29th. These are the last two odd nights that are remaining in this month. But again, best way is to work every night, so that you can guarantee that you catch the night of Qadr. One thing also that we all need to remember, none of us has a perfect fasting. None of us has a perfect fasting. That's why there is Zakat al-Fitr. Zakat al-Fitr is designed to make up for our shortcoming and deficiency in this month. So pay it as soon as possible. Don't wait until the last minute. I know some people, they pay it on the 8th day. That defeats the purpose, because it is meant to be collected and given to those who are in need so that they can share the joy of the Eid. So give it as soon as possible. I think they set it for $8 per person. Anybody, all your dependent, you pay for each one of them. So pay it as soon as possible. Now, in these days, especially the good news is we have those weekends. This weekend that we can take advantage of. Try to spend as much time as possible in the masjid. And speaking about spending time in the masjid, when you spend time in the masjid, you should not be distracted. That's the time. Yes, you are in the masjid and we are together, but at the end of the day, everybody should be busy worshiping and reciting Quran. I saw many people sometimes even during the night, they stay in the masjid but they stay talking. Talking and wasting time. That's not, that defeats the whole purpose. You be in the masjid, yes, we are together, but at the end of the day, each one of us should be completely focused on doing what you are supposed to do. So no, there is no time for distraction and there is no time to waste. Whether you are here or you are at home, these remaining days of Ramadan should be dedicated almost exclusively to worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, praying, dhikr, reciting the Quran, making dua. That's what you spend all the time that is under your control. Second part of the khutbah, I'm going to be talking about post-Ramadan. By the time we meet next week, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us life, Ramadan will be over and we're going to be post-Ramadan. First, we'll be talking about Eid, and then we'll be talking about post-Ramadan plan. Now, the Eid day, my dear respected brother and sister in Islam, for a community that is living in a non-Muslim society, it's an identity issue. Don't take it lightly. It's a very serious. It may not be for you, but for your children, it's very serious. You have to take it very seriously. I'm not going to tell you what to do, but I'm going to tell you one thing. Do everything you can to make this day very special for your children. To make it a day, they will remember it for a while. And then they will look up to it also months before. Why? Because you made it so special. With the time you spend with them, with the gifts, with the whole atmosphere, you made it so special that is something that they will remember it for a while. And then they will start looking up to it months ahead. That's our responsibility. Mainly as families and parents, and also as a community, to make it a very special day and not to take it casually and lightly, just another day. It's a very special, as I said, it's an identity issue. You have to know that this is their Eid. And again, it is the day of children, and it is a day of family, and your job is to do everything you can to make it a special day for the family and for the children. Now, post-Ramadan. Now, in 5 days, we're going to go through a very major transition. Tuesday night, after you break your fast, Ramadan is over. And we're going to switch to something else. One, those who are worshipping Ramadan, Ramadan is over. Those who are worshipping Allah, Allah is there. Now we're not worshipping Ramadan. Now we're taking advantage of the special opportunity of Ramadan. But we're going to continue beyond Ramadan, inshaAllah. Now, why transitions is important? When you transition from phase to another, and if you think about it, Muslims in general, Most of the time, we fail in transition. We fail in transition. Just think about it. When countries gained their independence, that was transition. They failed. Recently, Arab Spring, it was transition. It went well and then failed. A lot of time, this keeps happening in our life. That when we transition from one phase to another, we usually fail. And for one simple reason, because we don't plan ahead. Because we are caught unprepared. Because we are always thinking, we are very short-sighted. We're thinking about today and tomorrow, maybe. So by the time things change, we find ourselves totally unprepared. That was not the way Rasul ﷺ conduct himself. Rasul ﷺ was always starting a new phase before the current phase is over. That's why he kept the momentum of the companions, and they never had this problem when they transitioned from one phase to another. So lack of planning is the main reason why we fail. Now if you don't plan, Shaitan is planning. And I'm going to tell you about his plan. Shaitan, who is your enemy, has a plan for you. The plan is very simple. To bring you as quickly as possible down to pre-Ramadan level. Preferably from the perspective of the Shaitan, if he can do it on Tuesday night or Wednesday, so that he turns the page of Ramadan. So that Ramadan becomes like a break and you go back as if nothing happened. That's the plan of Shaitan. And he's going to try to execute it, and he's going to succeed with majority of Muslims, unfortunately. Why? Again, because people are not prepared. People are not planning, people are not prepared, they will be caught off guard. So what Shaitan wants to do, wants to make you lose all the gains you made in Ramadan as quickly as possible. So what should be our plan? To preserve the gains that we made in Ramadan, as much of the gains we made in Ramadan, as long as possible. And that starts when? That starts on Tuesday night. Tuesday night, you switch to a defense game. Now you're trying to preserve and protect the gains that you worked so hard to make in the month of Ramadan. And it's not going to be easy. Especially if you are not mentally prepared, it's very easy to surrender and go back to our comfort zone. It's not going to be easy, but at least we have to put a fight. We have to make Shaitan work very hard for every inch. Shaitan is trying to push us back. We're going to have to make him work very hard for every inch. We're not going to make his job easy. As I said, unfortunately, that's what's going to happen with the majority of Muslims. It will be very silly and very naive for someone to work so hard for a whole month and then squander all of this in one day. And that's unfortunately what's going to happen. That's why you stop seeing people after Ramadan, you stop seeing people in the masjid, you stop seeing people reading the Quran, etc. Why? Because that's how they were conditioned. They were conditioned mentally. Is this work is special in Ramadan. And then Ramadan is over, then we go back business as usual. And that has to change. And the way to do that is to force yourself. Start forcing yourself from Tuesday night. Come to Isha in the masjid. Yes, there is no Taraweeh. Come pray Isha in the masjid. Do it on Wednesday. Same thing. There is no Taraweeh in the masjid, pray few rak'ahs at home, at night. Part of forcing this and part of resisting this vicious plan of Shaitan, who, as I said, he wants to do the job as quickly as possible. So we have to start forcing ourselves from Tuesday night. Keep coming to the masjid, even if there is no Taraweeh. Keep praying Taraweeh even at home. Even if it is 2 rak'ah, 4, whatever you can. With the Quran that you know. Doesn't have to be big surahs. Start fasting the sixth day of Shawwal as early as possible. It is highly recommended that you fast 6 days after Ramadan. Rasulullah ﷺ said, the one who fasts Ramadan in 6 days of Shawwal, the month of Ramadan, as if he fasted the whole year. Start this as soon as possible. So that, as I said, you make it harder on Shaitan, and you remind yourself even that this game is not over. That Ramadan was an opportunity for us to move to the next level and to stay there, not to go back. Ramadan was meant to push you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from His mercy, gave us this opportunity. He cleared the road and gave us so many incentives and atmosphere and opportunity so that we can make a lot of gains. Was it meant that we lose them quickly? No. It was meant that you keep those as long as possible. Hopefully, until the next Ramadan. It's a struggle of a whole year to preserve the gains that you worked hard for them for a whole month. That's what you need to prepare yourself from now. And without preparation, as I said, it's going to be another transition, another failed transition. The reason why Muslims fail in transition time and again, because of lack of preparation. We always are busy with the current phase. We don't know what's going to happen next. So by the time the next phase started, we are not prepared. That happens even in our life. You know, in your family life, you go through phases. Your child was little child and then becomes teenager and then becomes etc. A lot of time we wait, we don't prepare for the next phase until it is too late. Until we discover that major problems have to be fixed. Why? Because we did not plan for this transition. That now we are transitioning to a different phase. Family, they start as couple, then there are children, then children will grow up, go from one phase to another, go to high school, go to college, etc. And most of the time people don't plan ahead. That's why people tend to fail in these transitions. So keep as much as possible of the gains you made in this month. Keep your relationship with the Quran as close as possible to your level during Ramadan. Keep your relationship with the masjid as close as possible to the level of Ramadan. Keep making dua as intensively as you are making dua in Ramadan. And keep making dhikr and remembrance and glorification of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as close as possible to your level during the month of Ramadan. Again, it's not going to be easy. But there is a huge difference between someone who's going to surrender and allow Shaitan to do his work, and between someone who's going to be prepared and will put a fight. That starting from Tuesday night, we are going to start resisting. Resisting what? Resisting the temptation to go back to our pre-Ramadan performance as if nothing happened. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ فَاتَّخِذُوهُ عَدُوًا. Shaitan is your enemy. Treat him as an enemy. There is nobody who is a wise person who has an enemy and you relax. There is somebody who vowed to make you fail and to mislead you and to deceive you, and then you just relax and don't be vigilant and don't be prepared to resist his plan and his temptation. So Tuesday night, the game will switch to become a defensive game. We're going to start defending the gains we worked hard for them for a whole month. For how long? For the whole year. For the whole year, you strive to preserve the gains that you made in this month. So this is my advice to all of us, inshallah. And the more prepared you are, the more, inshallah, you make it a smooth transition and you deny Shaitan the opportunity to deceive you or mislead you or make you lose gains that you worked so hard to make them. وَتُوبُ إِلَى اللَّهِ إِنَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونتوب إليه. نعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهدي الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, I'm going to go step further. This energy that we acquired in Ramadan, alhamdulillah, now you feel it. Feel yourself very motivated, full of energy, lot of confidence. You think that you can do so much because of what you did in Ramadan, and that's not easy. That's a lot, great accomplishment that you made in this month. This energy not only has to be preserved, but it has to be channeled in a constructive way. The energy that we gain in Ramadan has to be channeled in a constructive way. Now, for a couple of years now, I have been sharing with you some ideas, vision, project that is centered about around two things, basically. How we can change and how we can change our situation and our conditions. That's basically what we have been talking about for a while now. How can we transform or change ourselves? And then how can we change our situation and our condition? And we have been saying that this can happen only by discovering the true Islam and commit to it fully as a life mission, embracing Islam as a life mission. Inshallah, after Ramadan, we're planning to move to action and implementation. We have been talking with a number of brothers here of all ages. We recently started something for young professional even. And we're planning to move into action and implementation. Implementation of what? Basically, we're trying to figure out and find out what is it that Allah expects from us and do it. What is it that Allah wants to happen on earth and try to make it happen? Try to figure out what is the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and try to execute it. To do what needs to be done, to meet the expectation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to fulfill the purpose for which Allah has created us, so that we'll be prepared when we meet Him. We know why He brought us to this life, and we did it to the best of our ability. So I'm inviting all of you, especially those who have been around for a while and showed interest in this work. I'm inviting you to be part of this noble effort of doing the work of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you're interested to do that, please talk to me or join us on Sunday. We meet at 11:30 upstairs every Sunday. It's a class. Now it's going to be class and meeting to discuss how we can turn these ideas to reality and how we can implement them. Our situation is very bad, but it is not hopeless by all means. We have a great faith. We have a great model, the model of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. If we really understand this faith properly, take it seriously, implement the effective model of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we can and we will, inshallah, turn things around. That's not our destiny, to be in the back seat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala designated the community of believers to be leading, to be a model community and to be leading. Leading by example and leading by contribution. It's not our destiny to be in this situation. This is something that we did it for ourselves because we didn't do our homework. We didn't do our job, so we didn't qualify for the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now let us put our heads together and try to find out what is the job that Allah has assigned to us and do it to the best of our ability, and that inshallah will qualify us to the decisive help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who promised that in tansurullaha yansurkum, that if you advocate the cause of Allah, Allah will support you, and who says when yansurkum Allahu fala ghaliba lakum, that if Allah is on your side and supporting you, then there is nobody who can stop you. So please talk to me, talk to any of the brother, or join us on Sunday. And inshallah, recently, I get to know a couple of members of the community here. And amazing to what extent we don't know each other. I mean, these people, I've been praying next to them for so long. We don't know even each other's name. We have no clue about what we do for life. So that was very bad. I mean, very, it's embarrassing. community whose members don't know each other cannot go very far. Second, I was surprised in a positive way that there are so much talents in this community. There are so much talents and skills in our community, but they are not leveraged because nobody even knows about them. And because there is no vision or project to rally and to streamline these talents and these skills. People are smart, people have a lot of ideas, people have a lot of skills, people have a lot of resources, people have a lot of talents. And inshallah, we are determined to make this happen, to get to know members of our community and to leverage their skills and their talents so that inshallah, as I said, we turn things around. We cannot afford to leave this situation for our children. Already, young Muslims already are concealing their identity. They are not proud to be Muslim. That is because we did not give them anything to be proud of. And that has to change. And inshallah, it will. That once we discover the true Islam and practice it and share it and turn it into action, we will make inshallah, we will change our image and we will make our future generations very proud to be Muslims. Because that's what this deen is all about. It's a great faith, it's very inspiring, it's very empowering, but that's only the true faith that was brought by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that we all need to make an effort to try to discover it and then embody it and then turn it into models and into constructive action. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. اللهم اشف مرضانا وارحم موتانا. توفنا وانت راض عنا واختم بالصالحات أعمالنا واجعل خير أعمالنا خواتمها وخير أيامنا يوم نلقاك ومتعنا اللهم بالنظر إلى وجهك الكريم. ربنا ارحم والدينا كما ربونا صغارا وارحم موتانا وجميع موتى المسلمين. ربنا ارحم والدينا كما ربونا صغارا وارحم موتانا وجميع موتى المسلمين. اللهم أشهدنا ليلة القدر واجعلنا ممن يقومونها إيمانا واحتسابا. اللهم أشهدنا ليلة القدر واجعلنا ممن يقومونها إيمانا واحتسابا. اللهم اجعلنا ممن صاموا وقاموا رمضانا إيمانا واحتسابا. واجعلنا ممن غفر لهم ما تقدم من ذنبه. واجعلنا من عتقائك في هذا الشهر الكريم. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا. اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان واجعلنا من الراشدين. اللهم عنا على ذكرك وشكرك وطاعتك وحسن عبادتك. اللهم لا تدع لنا في جمعنا هذا ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا هما إلا فرجته ولا حاجة هي لك رضا إلا قضيتها. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين. صل اللهم على سيدنا محمد وأقم الصلاة.